NASA and NOAA have just released global temperature data for 2020. Where does the past year stand with these two different analyses and compared to 2016, which until now held the title for hottest year on record?
So 2020 is effectively statistically tied with 2016. So it was as warm as it was then. In our record, it was a little bit warmer. In the NOAA record, it was a little bit cooler. But those differences are well within the margins of error that we have for estimating this global temperature anomaly every year. So effectively, they're tied. And that's true across all the different products that people have put together from the UK, from Japan, from other efforts as well. So, I mean, it's pretty remarkable because if you remember, 2016 started off with this really large El Nino event in the tropical Pacific. And those events tend to give a boost to global temperatures. Yet last year, we did not have that. And right now we're going into a La Nina event that will mostly affect next year. But still, we didn't have a big El Nino, and yet we were still as warm as 2016. And that really is a testament to the power of the long-term trends. We've warmed more than 2 degrees Fahrenheit since the late 19th century. Those trends are continuing and may even be accelerating. And that's driven by our emissions of carbon dioxide and methane and other greenhouse gases.
Absolutely. So you mentioned some kind of previous projections and kind of how these long-term effects are catching up with us in a pretty serious way. I'm curious how, based on this growing data on global temperatures, how soon do you think we might reach that 1.5 degrees Celsius mark over pre-industrial levels that was set by the Paris Agreement?
Yeah, so let's be clear. I mean, nothing particularly terrible happens exactly at 1.5 degrees. What we're going to see is continuing amounts of damages and impacts increasing as the global mean temperature increases. But we will probably get our first year above 1.5 by the end of this decade, by 2030 or so. And then to be kind of like permanently above that number, that'll take maybe another 10 years.
Wow. So, I mean, I think that, you know, a lot of people within the climate science world are not surprised by by things like that, by saying right. That at the end of this decade, we'll start to see us hitting that mark and then hitting it more consistently over time. Right. But I think a lot of people will still be surprised to see how close we really are to that. Now, I'm curious, you know, just from what you know in your experience, what consequences from these rising temperatures and from where we're at in this these escalating temperatures, what consequences have we seen already, and how will those continue to worsen and grow as we near 1.5, exceed 1.5 in the coming years and decades?
Yeah, that's a great question. We're already seeing impacts, as you're well aware. The warming is leading to increasing numbers of heat waves. The area covered by heat waves at any one month or year is like 20% or something, when it should be like 1% of the planet. So we're definitely seeing increasing heat waves. Those heat waves are, or the warming in general, is giving rise to impacts on wildfires. We saw that very clearly in Siberia, Australia last year. We're seeing changes to drought intensity. So as it gets warmer, places that are in drought because of lack of rain, they're seeing a bigger impact on soil moisture because the warming is drying out the soils faster. We're seeing the impacts on sea level. Changes in the Arctic are the biggest changes that we're seeing. That's leading to dramatic decreases in the amount of sea ice in the Arctic, but also melting from the ice sheets on Greenland and the ice caps on the smaller islands. And those are all adding to sea level rise. And the sea level rise is leading to increases in coastal flooding, increases in storm surge and damages. And I haven't even got to the changes in rainfall or intense precipitation that's associated with some of those storms. So we're already seeing these impacts, and we can trace those impacts directly to the warming that we've seen. I think it's important to kind of put these things in context. You know, people don't really, I think, viscerally understand what 1 degree, 2 degrees, 3 degrees really means in terms of global mean temperature. So a really good way of conceptualizing it is to remember that the last ice age that ended about 20,000 well, ended about 10,000 years ago, but was kind of at its peak 20,000 years ago, was only about, you know, 5 degrees Celsius, 8 or 9 degrees Fahrenheit colder than the pre-industrial. And so the 2 degrees Fahrenheit that we've warmed since the 19th century, that's like a quarter of an ice age, right? But in the other direction. So, you know, for folks who say, oh, well, you know, these aren't big numbers. These are really big numbers for the Earth. And when you put it on the scale of previous changes on the Earth, like this is massive. And the fact that we're already seeing impacts tells us that, you know, if it gets much worse, the impacts are going to be very, very severe indeed.
Absolutely. And we have, you know, obviously I write for space.com. We often use space as a model. You know, we don't use space just to look at Earth using satellite data. But for example, when studying planets like Venus, we can see very directly how extremely a planet can change. And so I'm curious what you think about that, how looking at planets like Venus can kind of show us what could really happen with our planet, how the planet can continue in other states, the planet can evolve and change, but it will be hospitable.
I think you're right. There are a lot of contexts in which looking at the other solar system planets or even new exoplanets can help us kind of contextualize what's happening on Earth. I mean, we're not in any danger of turning into Venus anytime in the next like 2 billion years. But people don't really realize that Venus may have been the first habitable planet in the solar system. If you go back 3 billion years, Venus was well inside the habitable zone, and had it, and if it had retained its water, would have been able to support liquid water at the surface before all of the oceans evaporated as the sun kind of got warmer over those billions of years. We're looking at that with the same models that we use to look at Earth's climate. Right. So, there are important parallels, not that, you know, things are all going in the same direction, but, you know, the physics that we use to understand climate here on Earth, it's the same physics that we're using to understand the history of Venus or the history of Mars or what the potential climate might be on the TRAPPIST exoplanets or on Proxima Centauri B. I mean, like, you know, the connections that we have, you know, both in terms of how we think about the universe and the world and the solar system, and how we see changes right here on Earth, those are very, very clear parallels. And one of the nice things about working at NASA is that we can think about those larger contexts. You know, we can be involved in, you know, thinking about early Venus. We can be involved in thinking about technosignatures from other solar systems. We can think about climate change right here, right now. And it's the same people, and it's the same basic physics, and it's the same understanding of the system that kind of feeds off each other across those different fields.
Definitely. I mean, probably the most obvious connection between our growing understanding of Earth's climate and space is that so much important climate science data is from space-based observations. How do satellites and other, you know, space-based studies help us understand climate change?
Oh, so without them, we'd be totally lost. I mean, since about 1979, we've had, almost continuous measurements of, you know, things like ozone levels and water levels and now sea level and the geoid and the changes of mass on the planet that tells us where we're depleting groundwater and where the glaciers are melting, and the temperature itself and the clouds and the radiation, all of those instruments have led us to, you know, have a better idea of the processes that are going on. It's allowed us to build better simulations, and it's tracked the changes that we've seen. And so, you know, our understanding of what's happening is not totally perfect. You know, there's a lot of measurements that we're still not doing. Namely, you know, one of the most important ones is, you know, exactly what the particles in the atmosphere are doing, aerosols. What are they made of? How are they interacting with clouds? Those are still really large challenges for remote sensing. But without the input of the remote sensing data on sea ice and gravity and altimetry, we really would be lost. And so pulling all of those things together with the ground-based networks, with our understanding of the processes, really gives us a very rich picture of what's happening and why. And that allows us to make predictions for what's going to be coming up next.
Absolutely. So I just have one more question, but thank you again, Gavin. I really appreciate it. Obviously, there's a lot that people can take away from this kind of yearly data release and yearly global temperature release. In your opinion, what is the most important thing for people to take away from this information?
Yeah, so I think the thing that people mostly take away is, like, didn't we hear this story last year and the year before and the year before that and the year before that? And the answer is yes, you did. And you're going to continue to keep hearing it. It's going to be like a broken record because we keep breaking records because we're keeping warming the planet by increasing the amount of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere. Stop doing that and you won't ever hear from me again. And that'll be great.
Well, I hope that that is the case. And then we'll never have to bother them again. It'll be great. Awesome. Well, thank you again, Gavin. I really appreciate it.
You're welcome. Have a great day.